Have a seat. My name is Aaron Kaler, and I serve as one of the pastors here, and I want to welcome you to this gathering of the Hayes Hills Baptist Church. If you're our guest this morning, we are so glad that you are here with us and want to encourage you to grab one of the Connect cards out of the back of the seat in front of you. And on that card, you can jot down a little information about yourself. And we'd ask for you to place that in the offering when it's passed later in the service as your gift to us today. And it enables myself or another member of our staff to be able to reach out to you and hear how we can best come alongside you to minister to you, to serve you, to answer any questions you might have about the church. And so I hope you'll fill out that Connect card and place it in the offering as your gift to us today. If you're a member of Hayes Hills Baptist Church, I hope that you are paying attention to our missions partnerships each week. And this week, our missions partnership is with Help One Now in Haiti. And the advocacy team for Help One Now in Haiti is led by Bob and Beverly Shelton. You see their contact information there. It'll be in the newsletter again on Wednesday. If you would like more information about what's going on or would be interested in joining that advocacy team, you can be praying for the government to be able to curtail the gang activity that continues to wreak havoc there in the region. Pray for the people themselves, just worn out. It seems like every time they seem to have weathered one crisis, another seems to follow it. And so just an exhaustion among the citizens as well as the staff there at Yahweh Shema. And so we'll be praying for Help One Now Haiti just before the sermon in the pastoral prayer. I want to encourage you to be praying for them throughout the week. In addition, as you're praying for missions this week, in your bulletin this morning, you should have had a prayer guide for the International Mission Board's Week of Prayer for International Missions. And this is a great tool. I'd encourage you to use it over the next week. You can use it longer than that, but it just gives you an element of our over 3,600 IMB, International Mission Board missionaries on the field, how you can be praying for some of them in their work. And so I'd encourage you to use that in your time with the Lord over the next week. We are in the midst of our Lottie Moon Christmas offering. It's my favorite time of the year. We've got the sanctuary decorated beautifully. We're singing Christmas carols, and we get to collect that the name of Jesus Christ and salvation in his name might be declared throughout all the earth. And I am so thankful to be gathered in worship with you here this morning. We have our Lottie Moon post office that's just out in the foyer, and we have a brief video we're going to show you about how you can use that post office addressing cards to those who attend Hayes Hills and all the proceeds going to support the Lottie Moon Christmas offering for World Missions.
The Lottie Moon Post Office is a unique opportunity we have here at Hayes Hills every year to give to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, which supports missionaries all around the world. You participate in the post office, simply bring in the cards that you would normally mail to your friends here at Hayes Hills, and instead put them in the mailboxes at the post office out in the foyer. Then go to the donation box on the same table and drop your donation if you're able. Suggested donation is roughly whatever you would normally spend on postage to send out your Christmas cards. Then, each week during December, come down the resource hallway, look for the crate with the first letter of your last name, find the Ziploc bag with your last name on it, and take your Christmas cards. Lastly, don't forget to grab one of the missionary cards off the missions tree next to the post office table. Suggestion is to grab one card per week and have your family pray for that missionary throughout the week. Thanks for supporting the Lottie Moon Christmas offering by supporting the Lottie Moon Post Office, and Merry Christmas.
It's all right, you can clap. We're going to continue our worship this morning. If you would, stand with us.
The herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the sky.
Please.
Prince of Peace. Hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings.
Have a seat. We're going to take some time this morning to observe the Lord's Supper together. And as we do that, we want to let you know that this meal is for all of those who have put their hope and their trust in Jesus Christ. The brothers are going to distribute the elements here in just a few moments. We'd ask for you to hold those, and we'll partake of the supper together. What the Lord's Supper pictures is this reality that Jesus Christ, although we are all sinners deserving of death and hell, stepped into this world, and his body was broken and his blood was shed for us. That's the declaration.
God who created the heavens and the earth is not dependent upon what you have done or
The elements are a bit tricky. There's a thin plastic layer on the top you can peel back to expose the wafer. And just as this meal exists to remind all of those who've put their hope and their trust in Jesus Christ that they are welcome at the Lord's table, because our Lord is a God who is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. If you're here this morning and you have not put your hope and your trust in Jesus, we would encourage you not to partake of the supper, but that these elements are a reminder to you that yes, our God is a God of love and mercy and compassion, but as that passage goes on to say, he is also a God who will by no means clear the guilty. The only way to be forgiven, the only way to have a right relationship with the God who has created you and me is through putting your hope and your trust in the body and blood that was broken and shed for you, the body and blood of Jesus Christ. And so this meal exists to remind you, just as it reminds us that we are welcome at the Lord's table, it reminds you that the God who created you is inviting you to his table, but you must first repent of your sins and put your hope and trust in him. And so if you have not yet figured out what you believe about Jesus, we are so glad you are here. And we want you to continue to investigate and examine what you believe about Jesus. But we pray that this time would be a reminder that there is some unfinished business between you and the Lord. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, the Apostle Paul writes this. He says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" And so we're going to take some time to do just that. We're going to give thanks for the body of Jesus, and then we're going to partake of it in remembrance of him. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for the gift of the body of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, that you did not hide in the heavens, indifferent to our plight. Nor, Lord, did you stay in the heavens, compassionate towards us, but not knowing how to help and how to put an end to our sin and suffering. But, Lord, we thank you and we praise you this morning that in your infinite wisdom, infinite love, and infinite care, you descended to the earth. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We thank you, Lord, that Jesus took on flesh and lived a hard life, a life where foxes have holes and birds have nests, but the Son of Man, Jesus, had nowhere to lay his head. Born to a family so impoverished they could not afford a lamb at his dedication, but had to simply catch turtle doves with their hands. Lord, we thank you that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was willing to leave the riches of heaven and enter poverty here on earth, that we by his poverty might become rich, not with financial riches, but Lord, being blessed in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, as Ephesians 1 teaches us. Lord, we thank you for all of those blessings. We pray, Father, that we would cling to them and cling to Christ all the days of our life. And so, Father, we partake of this wafer, not because it is magical, but, Father, because it is a stopping point that you have created in our worship, that we might remember ourselves to you, that we might not distance ourselves from you, but that we might know that you are near and dear to every one of us. And it is in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. We do this in remembrance of him. Now you can peel back that next layer, give you access to the cup. And I will read the scriptural instructions, and then we will partake of the cup together, and then we will give thanks for the blood of Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul continues. He says, "In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Do this in remembrance of Jesus. Father, we thank you for the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed for us. We thank you that through his blood, you have given us a new covenant, not written on tablets of stone, but written on our hearts by your Spirit. We thank you that you have taken our hard and sinful hearts and given us in their place hearts of flesh. Lord, we thank you that not only have you given us this heart change, but that you, God, have sent God the Holy Spirit to dwell in each and every one of us. So, Father, that you are never far away. You are with us and very near to us at all times. Lord, we pray for those of us who have entered into this space, and Lord, we desperately want to hear from you. We want to know that we are loved by you, that you have not forsaken us or abandoned us. Lord, we pray that through this meal and, Lord, through the inner testimony of the Holy Spirit within us, that you would remind us now of your nearness, your love, and your care. Lord, I pray that when the enemy would accuse us and remind us of our many sins, that we would be reminded of the cleansing power of the blood of Jesus Christ. Father, that we would be reminded that at the cross, as your blood was shed, you declared those powerful words, "It is finished." And because it is finished, there is an end to the accusations of the enemy. And so, Father, I pray that we would each cling not to our own personal acts of righteousness, but to what has been won for us, the righteousness of Christ through his life, death, and resurrection. And Lord, I pray for those in this room right now who have yet to put their hope and their trust in you. Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would be at work now doing this work of regeneration. Lord, what you promised in the new covenant, that you would begin to write your law on their hearts, even as we pray. And it is in the name of Jesus, our Savior, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we ask it. Amen. I want to invite you to stand as we read together our congregational psalm for this morning. It comes from Psalm 96, which will be the text of our sermon today. And if you'll join me as we read verses 11 through 13. Let the heavens be glad, and let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar, and all that fills it. Let the field exult, and everything in it. Then shall all the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord, for he comes. For he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples in his faithfulness. This is God's word to us today. You may be seated. Kids at this time, K through 5th, are dismissed to attend children's worship. As always, kids are welcome in our services, but we do have this time of child-focused instruction in the Word of God and in the love of Jesus Christ, if you'd like to take advantage of it. And if this is your first Christmas with us, you're probably wondering why we prominently feature this creepy cutout. And I'm convinced that perhaps if it was in color, it wouldn't be quite so bothersome. It'd be a little more accessible. But all we have is black and white photos because this is a Lottie Moon. And this is a life-size cutout of Lottie Moon. She was 4 feet, 3 inches tall. And Lottie was born in 1840 to a wealthy family. In fact, so wealthy that by 1860, if you adjust for today's dollar, she had $2.2 million in cash alone in her possession. So a very wealthy family. They lived, their next door neighbor was actually Thomas Jefferson's home, Monticello, there in Virginia. And so the world was open to Lottie in ways it wasn't open to most people. In fact, her older sister, Ori, was the first woman in the state of Virginia to graduate with a medical degree. She was only the second woman in the South to graduate with a medical degree. And so because of her family's wealth, she had a lot of opportunity in this world. Opportunity that a lot of people don't have. Many of you do not have. And yet she chose to give her life in service as a missionary to the people of China. In fact, at the age of 72, in 1912, when civil war broke out in China, and the U.S. consul instructed all the missionaries to flee to port towns where they could be protected, and all the missionaries left, including Lottie. The difference was everybody else went to a port city, and Lottie went inland where the fighting was the fiercest so that she might assist with the wounded. It's just a different spirit about her. Toughness in that 4 foot, 3 inch frame. And Lottie would die later that year. And 5 years after her death, the Women's Missionary Union named the annual Christmas offering for world missions in her honor. And every year since, Southern Baptists around the world have collected the Lottie Moon Christmas offering for world missions. To date, that offering has raised over $1.5 billion for the sake of missions throughout the world. And as we speak this morning, we have over 3,600 IMB International Mission Board missionaries on the field who are supported largely by this offering each Christmas. Lottie Moon is a Southern Baptist hero, and she is one of my great heroes. And if you're here this morning, you might wonder, well, why would you have a hero like that? I mean, why would someone like Lottie Moon, who had the world open to her, why would she give her life to the people of China? I mean, there are lots of people in the United States who need Jesus, lots of lostness here. Why would she give up all of the fortune, all of the opportunities, and go to China? Why should any of us consider lives like that? Why do we here at Hayes Hills talk about missions all of the time? And those are the kinds of questions I want to answer for us as we look at God's Word in Psalm 96 this morning. And so if you brought your Bible, and I hope you did, I want to invite you to join me there, Psalm 96. If you've got a digital device you can use to pull up the Bible, I'll be reading from the English Standard Version, the ESV, this morning, so you can search for the ESV, English Standard Version, Psalm 96, and you'll be able to follow right along with me. But before we take some time to look at God's Word in the 96th Psalm, I want to ask you to take some time to talk to God together with me. Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning for the work of Help One Now in Haiti. We do pray that, Lord, you would bring to power a government that would be just and would be able to curtail gang activity that so regularly seems to plague the region. We pray for the pastors and staff of Yahweh Shema. We ask that they would be able to meet the needs of the children, be able to encourage their hearts and point them to the hope of salvation in Jesus Christ and the stability that He promises in the new heavens and new earth. Lord, we confess that we can often look at situations in places like Haiti with a little bit of an arrogant heart, feeling superior, and yet we must acknowledge that this past week here in our nation, the Supreme Court in our land heard oral arguments about whether we should have legalized abortion in this country. So, Father, we pray for your forgiveness and your mercy and your help. Lord, we acknowledge that among us there are many who have had an abortion, paid for an abortion, encouraged an abortion. We thank you for the forgiveness that is available to us in Jesus Christ. And Lord, we pray, Father, that you would put an end to legalized abortion here. We pray that the justices of the court would adjudicate in a way that is pleasing to you and defends the rights of the unborn. We pray that as your church, we would not respond to whatever happens with arrogance, but instead there would be a humble gentleness as we converse with our neighbors, our coworkers, our family members, and friends. We pray that Lord Roe would be overturned and that your church would stand eager and ready to fill the void in realms like foster care and adoption and providing financial assistance for young couples that are struggling to make ends meet. We pray that we would demonstrate that we are not a people seeking for legislative solutions to problems, but that we are a people motivated by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to love our neighbor as ourself. Lord, we pray for your goodness and your kindness to be evident in our evangelistic zeal. We ask that we would be faithful to tell it to two, for each member of this church to be praying regularly for the salvation of two non-believers and opportunities to speak the good news of the gospel to them. We pray that in that way, our eyes would be open to the many opportunities that exist before us each and every day to point people to Jesus. And we pray for our Lottie Moon Christmas offering. We ask that as we give generously, faithfully, sacrificially together, Lord, that a great offering would be collected, that people around the world might hear the good news of salvation in Jesus Christ. And we ask this all in the name of Jesus, our Savior, by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Psalm 96, I'm going to begin reading there in verse 1. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Tremble before him all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens be glad and let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar and all that fills it. Let the field exult and everything in it. Then shall all the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord, for he comes. For he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples in his faithfulness. And the grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. And this is God's word to us today. And what I want to try to demonstrate this morning, if you're the kind of person who says, hey, why would someone like Lottie Moon go to China? There are lost people here. Why would a church like ours call us to be concerned with missions, with telling other nations about Jesus? Why can't we focus here first? Why are we encouraging our young people? Why are we encouraging our retired adults to consider giving their lives and going as full-time missionaries on the field? Why would we do that? I want to try to demonstrate from this text this single reality, that worship without missions in this world is woefully inadequate. That worship without missions is woefully inadequate in this world. That is the thesis. And I want to try to demonstrate that in three simple statements that we can see here in our text. That worship without missions, if all we do is gather here, if all we do is sing praises here, if all we do is speak of Jesus to those around us in our community here, our worship will be woefully inadequate. And I want to give you three reasons why. First, because of the scope of God's kingdom. Because of the scope of God's kingdom. And I'm going to go full-fledged Bible geek mode here, so I'm just prepping you for that, all right? And I want to show you how the structure of this text is speaking to this reality. And so if you have a pen, I would encourage you, you might want to take some notes in the margin of your Bible. This is with the help of a man by the name of Conrad Schaefer. What Schaefer points out, I think is really helpful for us to see, is that in the Bible, very consistently, the number seven is symbolic of perfection, of completion, totality. And so I want to show you all of the sevens that exist in this text. And I got to tell you, when I saw all of this week, I just had to stop and give praise to the Lord for how beautifully and wonderfully his word is composed. So first, I want you to see that there are two sets of seven for a total of 14 imperatives here in the first 10 verses of the text. Look at it. In verses 1 and 2, three times we're told to sing to the Lord. We're told to bless His name. We're told to tell of His salvation. Then we're to declare His glory. Three times we're told in verses 7 and 8 to ascribe to the Lord. Then we're told to bring an offering. We're told to come into His courts. We're told to worship the Lord. We're told to tremble before Him. And then verse 10, 14th, final imperative of these two sets of sevens, we are to say among the nations. And what are we to say? The Lord reigns. But that's not all. After this declaration in verse 10 that the Lord reigns, two sets of seven, 14 imperatives, notice there are seven effects of the Lord's reigning given here in the text. First, the stability of the world. The world is established. It shall never be moved. Second, fair government. He will judge the peoples with equity. Then we're told five things will rejoice. The heavens, the earth, the sea, the field, and the forest will all sing for joy. So we have 14 imperatives, two sets of seven, that lead into this statement, the Lord reigns. Then we're given seven effects of the Lord's reigning. And yet there's more. I mean, this is like a really bad infomercial, isn't it? Well, wait, there's more. Because seven times the synonyms peoples and nations, translated in English, peoples and nations, seven times occurs in the text. And the word all occurs seven times as well. And so the structure of the text itself is declaring this reality, that the Lord reigns over all the earth. The scope of God's kingdom is all of creation. But it's not just the structure of the text that declares that, it's also the setting of the text. Now, Psalm 96 doesn't have a superscript that tells us its origin. But thanks to 1 Chronicles 16, we know the original setting of this psalm. When King David came to power and set his throne, his capital, in Jerusalem, he wanted not only for his throne to be in Jerusalem, but he wanted the Ark of the Covenant there as well. And some of you, your only exposure to the Ark of the Covenant may be Indiana Jones, so all you're aware of is that it apparently has the power to melt the faces of Nazis. But when we move from the fictional realm of Indiana Jones back into the historical record of the Bible, what we find is that the Ark of the Covenant is actually the symbol of God's immediate presence. It's where the Lord lives. And so David wants the Ark of the Covenant in Jerusalem so that Israel and the world might understand it is not King David who rules over Israel, but the Lord Himself. Now, the ark has been filled with a lot of trouble because when people mishandle it, bad things happen to them, including, you know, Nazis. And so the ark has sat in Kiriath Jearim for over 60 years. But when David gets ready to move the ark and safely transport it into the capital there in Jerusalem, he asks for this guy, Asaph, the choir leader, to compose a psalm to commemorate the occasion. And it is this psalm, Psalm 96, that they sing as they proceed with the ark into the capital. Now, why would they sing Psalm 96? Why would Asaph compose a song like this as they bring the ark into Jerusalem? It's because before David got there, there was another king in Jerusalem, and he wasn't an Israelite. He was a Jebusite. He was the king of the Jebusites. And so as the ark comes into the city, they are triumphantly declaring, "Our God, our Lord, He rules and reigns over all the earth." The setting of the text is declaring it. But not just the original setting. We are given in the Septuagint, there's no superscript in the Masoretic text, which is the Hebrew text we use primarily to translate the English Bible, but the Septuagint is the Greek translation of the Hebrew Old Testament. It's the Bible Jesus used in His day. It's what He quoted from in His ministry. And in the Septuagint, there is a superscript at the start of Psalm 96. And it contains these three words: return from captivity. And what that's indicating is that years and years after David's rule and reign, when the people of Israel had been conquered by the Babylonians, led into exile, the temple was in ruins, the city was in ruins. As the book of Ezra records, the people return after years upon years upon years. They return and they begin to rebuild the temple. And when they rebuild the temple and they dedicate that temple, you know what song they sing? Psalm 96. And I want you to think about the kind of confidence and courage it takes to sing this psalm in that setting. I mean, God's people have been conquered by their enemies. They've been carried off into exile. They're just now beginning to rebuild the ruins, and they sing and they declare, "The Lord reigns. He rules and he reigns over all the earth." And they want to remind themselves and their children and the watching world who their God is. The setting of the psalm is declaring the scope of God's kingdom requires us to speak the good news of the gospel to all the peoples of the earth. Because you see, there's a time in Israel's history, it's recorded in 1 Kings chapter 20, when the Syrians go to battle against Israel. And the Syrians vastly outnumber Israel. They're expecting to just go in and mop them up. And they fight against the Israelites, and the Israelites defeat them. The Syrians are puzzled by this, and they're trying to figure out what happened. And the king's advisors come to him, and they say to the Syrian king, "You know, we figured out what the problem was. Their God is the God of the hills. And we fought them in the hills where their God has power. If we drop the battle lines in the plains, then we'll demolish them." And so that's what they do. They drop the battle lines in the plains, thinking that now they've got, you know, Yahweh, they've got the Lord on their territory, and they'll be able to conquer him. But our God says, "Oh, you've messed up now. You think I'm just the God of the hills? So now I really got to put a whooping on you so you understand who I really am. I am the God who rules and reigns, not just in the hills, but in all of creation." And the Syrians are destroyed. And brothers and sisters, if our worship simply consists of us gathering in this place on the Lord's Day and singing praise to him, if our worship consists of us observing the Lord's Supper and going out and speaking the good news of the gospel to those around us, making disciples here in Central Texas, Buda, Kyle, South Austin, telling the good news throughout the state of Texas, maybe even throughout the United States, but we stop there. If that's what our worship consists of, it will be woefully inadequate, because what we are signaling through both our worship and our witness is that our God rules and reigns here. But you see, our God rules and reigns everywhere. Notice verse 3, we are to declare his glory among the nations, not just some of them. It makes sure it clears up in the second line, his marvelous works among all the peoples. Verse 10, we are to say among the nations, not just some of them, but all of them, the Lord reigns. And so if our worship is to be adequate in the sight of our Lord, we have got to declare to the nations, the Lord reigns. There is salvation in no one else. But not only do I want you to see here in Psalm 96 that worship without missions is woefully inadequate in this world because of the scope of God's kingdom. Secondly, I want you to see it's woefully inadequate because of the scale of God's glory. It's woefully inadequate because of the scale of God's glory. Look at verse 8 with me. There we're told to ascribe to the Lord, that is, give to the Lord, the glory due his name. And I know this is an Old Testament psalm, but if you were to ask me to summarize the teaching of the New Testament in 3 words, I know the answer I'd give you. I would have given it to you off the top of my head, even if I hadn't prepared a sermon this week. I would have said that the teaching of the New Testament is this: Jesus is Lord. That's the summary of the New Testament. And so the Lord who reigns, the Lord who is to be praised, the Lord to whom we are to give glory due his name is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That, in fact, is what you have gathered to do today, isn't it? Amen? To give the Lord Jesus Christ the glory due his name. And so I want us to think for just a moment about his literal name. I mean, why was Jesus given the name Jesus? In Matthew chapter 1, we're told an angel appeared to Joseph and instructed Joseph, you're to name your son Jesus because, quote, he will save his people from their sins. And the question is, well, who are his people? And John the Baptist puts it this way. He says, well, Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. John the Apostle says he's the propitiation for our sins, but not for our sins only, also for the sins of the whole world. In Revelation, we find those in the heavens are singing to Jesus, even now, the Lamb of God, to Jesus. They are singing, you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe, language, people, and nation. And so the only way I can ascribe glory due to Jesus, due to his name, is to make sure that I am demonstrating that he is the God who has taken away the sins of the world. Not just my sins, your sins, not just the sins of this nation or that nation, but the sins of every single person on this planet. His body was broken and his blood was shed so that if they would put their hope and their trust in him, they would find forgiveness and life in his name. And so notice here in the text, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. Do you believe that? I mean, do you believe that the Lord and he is to be praised? Not just a little bit, but greatly he is to be praised. You see, the more you understand that God is great and that he is to be praised greatly, the more you understand the glory of God, the more you will be motivated to go and declare his greatness to all peoples. And so if you're not engaged in missions, if you look at your life and you say, you know what, I've been a Christian for a while, but I'm not part of, you know, any of these advocacy teams. I don't really care to be. I don't tend to give a whole lot. I don't tend to pray much for missions. I'm just kind of here. I would just say it may be that you don't understand the scale of God's glory. Because the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. And we are to declare his marvelous works among all the peoples. And the more you see the scope of his kingdom and the scale of his glory, the more you will delight in seeing him be made known among all peoples. I'm going to ad lib a moment here. But several years ago, there was an opportunity. Art Rendon and myself and Eric Patterson headed to the Himalayas. And as we ascended the heights there of Solukhumbu, among the people of Nepal, frontier area of the gospel, I'll tell you, it was a hard 14-hour jeep ride, wasn't it, brother? We had a vehicle in front of us fall off the mountain and tumble down. We had a bus that had to be spiked. It had gone off and had to be spiked down with a chain as they got people off. But there was nowhere in this world I wanted to be more than to be at the top of those mountains and to be able to declare the glory of God, because he is worth it. And because I want all peoples to know that the Lord rules and he reigns. And the more you become convinced that God is glorious, that he is great and greatly to be praised, the more your heart will desire to share that good news with every single person on the planet. And so worship without missions is woefully inadequate in this world because of the scope of God's kingdom and the scale of his glory. But third, I want you to see that worship without missions is woefully inadequate because of the science of God's rule. The science of God's rule. Oxford Dictionary defines science this way. It says, science is the systematic study of the structure and behavior of the natural and physical world by experimentation and observation. That's what science is. So if you were to walk into one of the elementary schools here in our community during their science fair, you'd find a lot of those trifold, corrugated cardboard things. I think like science fairs are the only use for those things left in the world, you know? And in one of those science fairs, you might find a child who has as their experiment, They're trying to answer the question, which color of paint reflects the most light, reduces heat in a home, and so saves money on air conditioning costs? And they would have a hypothesis. They'd say, this is the color of paint that I think is going to reflect the most light, save the most on air conditioning costs. Here's why I think that. And then they would begin to test it. They would experiment, and they'd try one color of paint, and they'd test it, and try another, and another, and another. And then at the end of all of their experimentation, they would have the results, and they'd say, this is the color of paint that reflects the most light. Here's what my tests show. And we would say, that is science, Here's what we found. Here's what we've discovered. And what the writer of the text is saying is that there is a science associated with God's rule. People, they have had all kinds of hypotheses about, what if we worship this God in this way? What if we worship that God in that way? What will happen to us as a people? What will happen in my life? There has been a lot of experimentation with a lot of different gods, but the results are in. Look at it there in verse 4. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. And some people take that and they run with it and they say, look, that's just evidence that the Bible is affirming the existence of other gods. That Jesus might be chief among all gods, but that, there are other lesser gods too. But I want you to notice what he does in verse 5 immediately following. He says, for all the gods of the peoples are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Now that's pretty clear in English. Pretty clear what he's saying. But there's a fascinating wordplay that's happening in the Hebrew here. Because one of the words for God in Hebrew, you may have heard it before, is Elohim. You heard that before? Elohim. It's plural for God. And so in verse 5, it's literally, for the Elohim, the gods of the people, and then he uses this word, Elohim. You hear that? Elohim, the gods of the people are Elohim, and Elohim means nothings. Isn't that beautiful? The Elohim of the people are Elohim, nothings. And he's saying, look, they have experimented with this God and that God and worshiping him in that way and this way, but what has been discovered, the results of our science project are in, and the gods of the peoples are nothings. They are just the invention of man, but the Lord, our God, invented man, created man. He made the heavens. And so as my mentor, Dr. Waltke, says, God's people can never be politically correct. Like, you try walking into your class on multiculturalism and saying, the Lord reigns, all the gods of the peoples are worthless idols, like they're going to, Because the tenet of multiculturalism is, hey, every culture is equal. Lots of different cultures have different gods. They worship them in different ways. They all have value. They all have worth. There are all these kinds of different approaches that are of spiritual help and good to people. But the psalmist says something much different. The psalmist says, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He's to be feared above all gods, for all the gods of the people are worthless idols. But the Lord made the heavens. And so you can't back away as a Christian when other people say, see, you're just this imperialist who's trying to force your way of life and your culture on these people in other countries. You can't back away and shy away when that charge comes. You have to say, no, you don't understand. The scope of God's kingdom, the Lord Jesus Christ, he rules and reigns over all the earth. And it is not because I'm trying to force this person to believe like me. It is actually because I love my neighbor as I love myself. And I understand that it is only when we respect the rightful rule and reign of King Jesus that we will have peace and stability in the earth. Notice, when we say among the nations, the Lord reigns, the good news is he will come and he will judge the peoples with equity. And it is then and only then that the heavens and the earth, the sea, the forest, the fields will rejoice. And so it is out of love of neighbor, not an imperialistic spirit, but love of neighbor that I go and I speak to them of the good news of salvation in Jesus Christ. I want to be very sensitive to their culture, and I want to be sensitive and respect their values, but I also want to declare to them the truth, that the gods of the people are worthless idols. It is the Lord who is great and greatly to be praised. And so love and logic both compel us on mission, because only as we respect the rule of Jesus Christ will we have peace and joy in this life. And so you wonder, you know, why would Lottie Moon give her life? Why would she give up all of those opportunities to speak the good news of the gospel to the people of China? It's because she understood the scope of God's kingdom, the scale of his glory, and the science of his rule. What about you? You know, what are you doing to engage in missionary activity? You know, one of the easiest ways you can get involved is by joining one of our advocacy teams. You see the contact information on the slide each week. It's there in the newsletter. You can call and contact, email one of the advocacy team leaders. Say, hey, I just want to meet once a month, be able to pray with and for our missionaries, seek to encourage them. You know, you can grab cards off the Christmas tree in the foyer and be praying for our missionaries this week. You can use your prayer guide that was in your bulletin to be praying for IMB missionaries on the field. You can give generously, sacrificially to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. The good news of salvation in Jesus might be declared throughout all the earth. And perhaps the Lord is calling you. I've said before, and I will say many times, I pray that when my time at Hayes Hills is done, whenever the Lord would make that day come, that the measure of my ministry here would be marked by the number of people we send to the mission field. And so is the Holy Spirit calling you today to go? Are you one of those he's going to use to declare his marvelous works to all the peoples? No better way to spend a life if the Spirit is calling. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for the good gift of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We pray that your Spirit would be at work within us as a congregation to motivate us to be on mission. We pray that there would be no unreached peoples, no unengaged peoples. Father, because we would be willing and churches like us willing to sacrifice so that the name of Jesus might be known by every man, woman, and child on this planet. And it is in the name of Jesus and by the power of his Spirit we pray. Amen.
To the core of the kingdom, lift your eyes to the King. Let his song arise within you as a fragrant offering of how God rich in mercy came in Christ to redeem all who trust in his unfading grace. Be children of light with the mercy of heaven, the humility of Christ, walking justly before him, loving all that is right, that the life of Christ may shine through us. King of heaven, he will answer the call. He will follow.
Would you pray with me? Father, we do thank you for salvation in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we do pray that the nations would put their trust in you. Lord, we pray that this nation would put its trust in you. And so, Father, we pray that we would give you not only our tithes and our offerings, Lord, not only our money, but that we would give you our very lives in service. Father, that our lives would be on the altar, and that, Father, how we live Monday through Saturday would be lumped in with our worship, not just what we do on the Lord's Day. Father, that you would use us in such a way in our places of work and, Lord, in our schools to point others to the good news of salvation in Jesus Christ. And we ask this all in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. I want to thank you for joining us in worship today here at Hayes Hills. Always such a joy and privilege to be able to worship Jesus alongside you. And we are in the midst of our Lottie Moon Christmas offering for World Missions. Our official goal is $20,000 this year. And as you know, if you've been here sometime, I always pray for a little more than that. And this year, it feels a little crazy, but I've just been asking the Lord that we would be able to give $40,000 to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering for World Missions. And for that to happen, in a church our size, it means the level of sacrifice on average would be $175 given by every family to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering for World Missions. And I acknowledge, I understand that for all of us, the level of sacrifice is going to be different. For some of us, sacrifice is going to look less than that. For some of us, it's going to look more than that. But I believe that as we give faithfully, generously, sacrificially together, that the Lord is going to do great things. And so I just want to encourage you to give a gift to the nations before you even give a gift to your families this Christmas. To say, one of the ways I show the worthiness of Christ and the good news of the gospel is by giving to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering for World Missions. You can do that by noting Lottie Moon on the memo line of your check. You can give through the website or the Church Center app and just select the Lottie Moon Christmas offering drop down. And I'm praying that at the end of this Christmas season, we'll get to celebrate a new record giving to Lottie Moon and what the Lord will do through those funds by sending missionaries throughout the world to declare the good news of salvation in Jesus Christ. I want to tell you, as I told the first service this morning, nothing makes me more proud as a pastor here at Hayes Hills than to see the development of our missions culture over the last 5 years or so. To be able to increase the missions line item of our budget in 2022 by over 50% in a single year, I'll tell you, that gives me joy as a pastor like nothing else. And it is because of your generosity and your faithfulness and your sacrifice to continue to give to the nations. And so thank you. It makes my heart rejoice. It makes me proud to be here among you. And it makes me excited to see what the Lord has yet in store for us as a people. So I want to invite you to stand. We're going to sing our closing song. We're going to praise the God from whom all blessings flow. And then you're going to be sent out to speak the good news of the gospel to a world that desperately needs to hear it.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly ghost. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Y'all have a blessed Sunday.